in a second now.
You're lying.
And because it doesn't automatically tweet anymore, I better tweet too.
Maybe.
Something will re-add your Twitter back in because they did a wipe of all that data because something in Twitch got compromised and they'd rather be safe than sorry.
Oh, sure. That's what they all say.
Yeah, I know it's true because that's what Sony tells me.
Oh, like I believe Sony.
Well, you better believe them. You have all the proof in their emails right there. And there, and there, and there, and there.
What's up, Svensson? What you doing? Thanks.
There we go. Tweeted.
I'm Aslew.
And retweeted.
And retweeted.
Oh.
Well, at least you know my phone is silenced because you didn't hear the Zelda. I got a text alert from Twitter.
Wow, that's a long text alert.
Sure, I hear it.
I'm doing all right, Svensson.
And hello, chat room.
I could complain, but I'm not gonna.
You should.
It's not how people actually phrase that, but that's how I phrase that.
Oh, John, did you... Okay, good, you did. Making sure that you put that listener feedback in that we got earlier today.
Yeah, the all-important listener feedback. How we broke WoW.
I dropped it.
Did the title get changed on the page? I just have to refresh to see, or is it not?
It should have been changed.
Okay, yeah, I probably have to refresh the page to change it. I'm not gonna, because then I'd lose the chat backlog. Might miss something.
Well, here, I'm going to open it up on another window to make sure it did.
Yes, the Dawnforge tweet cannon. We have access to all of the Dawnforge accounts with one click of a button.
Oh, my. That's too much power for one man.
No one.
It's like the 13 accounts.
Standing by the railless Death Star cannon.
That guy. 13 accounts in one click. You send the tweet on one, and the other one's all retweeted.
Look, they said that if we had a rail, we'd lean.
If you got time to lean, you got time to clean.
I seem in a good mood. Well, I would hope so. I had a really bad day.
How bad was it?
It was so bad that if it was mayonnaise, it would have expired a year ago.
It's Ben's secret. That's what everybody doesn't know, is that the happier Ben sees, the madder he actually is.
No, the happier I seem, the stronger I am.
No, that's not true.
So you're some sort of reversal?
Kind of.
Hulk happy! Hulk have nothing but good thoughts! Hulk strongest one there is now!
Hulk so happy! Hulk pet puppy!
Why? What?
It's like you crossed Hulk with a Care Bear.
Jeez, man.
I know, I'm horrible.
Actually, that'd probably be the most terrifying thing in existence. Hulk and a Care Bear mixed together. Hulk Bear Stare! He just glares at you.
Oh, I get enough people glaring at me as it is. Like John. He doesn't know what.
Now I'm just picturing Hulk in fuzzy pajamas. Fuzzy footy pajamas.
Oh yeah, John, if you didn't know, Alessander has been listening to Azeroth Survivor.
I'm sorry,
or Survivor Alessandra. Azeroth, whoever it goes.
I apologize for all of that. And the role I played.
You played a rather important one, actually.
I just want to say three.
There you go, Ben. That was for you.
Thanks. That and with pillows are the two greatest things that came out of flex mode.
With pillows?
No, not with pillows. No one gets pillows. You have to sleep on the ground and like it.
Aww. Okay, click right. Hide video preview. Why isn't it hiding? Hey, I hit it.
Hey.
I did it.
Hi.
I did it.
Hi. Good. Good for you. Ben, if you lean in too far, it's going to look like you're trying to taste that little jagged piece of the overlay.
I'm just going to try and blend in with the Murlocs.
Yeah, look at that. He's going for it.
Oh, here, we'll do this. One. Aww.
Have him pick your nose.
Oh, that's hard to do because the camera's over here, but I see the overlay over there. So hold on.
You're like doing a weird ET thing right now.
Oh, yeah, right there. What? Thanks, buddy.
You're blinking like crazy while that happened. That was weird.
So you can pick your Murloc, right? You can pick your nose. But you can't have a mirror Murloc pick your nose.
I also heard that you can tune a piano, but you can't tune a fish.
And you can't roll a Murloc tune either.
All right, everybody, what do you say we do a show?
I think it's time we start a show.
Jeez.
I don't know. It's getting kind of late.
It's getting late. Let's go.
Start us off.
Please don't put that on the recording.
Oh, it's totally going to be in there.
You should have thought of that before you did it.
This is DG from the Groupquest podcast, and you're listening to Azeroth Roundtable.
You know, I got to say, in the chat room, with Kilroy saying, hey, you guys, it makes me think of Sloth from Goonies.
Yeah. That might have been what Kilroy was referencing.
And that's how we're going to start this episode.
Sorry, Kilroy distracted me. It's all his fault.
We like to keep this show starting very uniformly and then immediately descending into the most unprofessional thing you've ever heard.
Guys, look over there, an obvious distraction.
Wait, what?
Sometimes we don't even make it through the intro before it falls apart, but yeah. We try to at least let that part sound okay.
Exactly. Exactly. Welcome to Azeroth Roundtable, episode 111 or 111 or... What is that in binary? Anybody know?
7.
Good day. Please power down your computer.
Okay.
Cool. Binary, that's 7.
Oh, good. Good to know. Anyways, I am Ben Bumhofer. With me, as always, is John Jagger. How's it going, John?
It's going good, Ben. Do you know it would be another 111 episodes before the number lines up like this again?
Are you... Really?
Yeah.
Okay. With us this week... we have DG. How's it going, DG? Welcome to the show.
It's nice to be here. I've never been on this show before. So 111 episodes in, you finally got... Well, I don't know when your last new guest was, but I know you've had a string of repeat guests recently.
Who was our last new guest?
Oh, and they're going to have to make me do work.
Yep. He's going to bring it up. I want to know. I don't want to make our listeners go and do research. They got to go.
I would say it was Amy Jane last week, but it's not true.
Their needs, and my need is to know that fact.
Oh, it wasn't long at all. It was Seraphis.
Yeah, that's right.
Time on.
It was really? 2 weeks ago.
Hmm. Yeah.
Well, then I'm in good company with people who are appearing for the first time, because that someone certainly won a certain contest.
Acting like we only have the same people on.
Well, right side, I guess I only have to wait till episode 211 before I'll be back on, so...
No,
222.
Oh. Well, but the other ones only had to wait 100 episodes.
Well, it's the new thing. We're doing 110 now. Starting with you.
111, you mean?
Yeah, something like that.
I don't know. Maybe it's so we'll monumentous. Bring you on 110. Depends on your behavior.
But yeah, it's so monumentous.
Episodes off for good behavior now.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Questioning our decisions will get you an extra episode.
Questioning our decisions? That's paddling. Yeah. Maybe a reference to Simpson? That's a paddling.
Yeah, you're up to 114 now.
So, DG, how you doing? What have you been up to either in or out of WoW?
In WoW, this week is my last week working 5 nights a week. We've had an extended schedule at work for ramped up production. I work 10-hour nights, so I'll be going back to 4 hours, 4 days a week, so I'll have more WoW time now and actually be able to get into a pattern of doing things rather than just logging in, doing garrison, going to bed. But I have been working on pet leveling in the meantime.
All right.
I've been hitting, since I play Alliance, hitting Ashley in Chattermoon Valley, which is an easy fight. Hitting a few of them in Pandaria that I can carry a level one pet through. And I've been using a new add-on called Rematch for the last month. And it allows you to queue a leveling list and makes it really easy. So I highly recommend if you're into pet battling, get Rematch.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree.
Actually allows you to save teams based on who you're targeting. So when you click on a trainer, it goes, this is the team you have saved to this trainer. Would you like to load it? And you can actually save your leveling list as one of the slots in there. So makes it easy, quick, and painless.
Mm-hmm. Now, started using that as well. It is a great add-on. I have no idea who does it, but whoever makes it, they need to be hired by Blizzard and added to the UI team.
Yeah, it's probably it's better than the one I was using, and I don't like changing add-ons much, but that one went out of date, so I went looking for something new, and Rematch is perfect! Great, love it. Tangently related to WoW, I finally got, I have a Card Against Humanity custom deck on cardcastgame.com, and I've got that up to 690 cards now, which was my goal, because I believe that's Mythic Blackrock Foundry gear level, right? I was like, before Hellfire Citadel drops, I got to get this to the eye level, and then I can worry about getting more in after that. So I've got that up to there. There are some people who've played with it. I know Torin Think Tank uses it in their every monthly gaming stream. Mm-hmm. So it's a good deck, a lot of fun. Cannot talk about it much on here because it's Cards Against Humanity deck and everything that entails.
I appreciate that, because John would totally insist and make me bleep the whole thing out.
Yeah, I would.
Well, I mean, I can load one until I get
We're good. We're good.
Nope,
we're fine.
That's all right.
Nope, no, we're good.
Yep, that's cool. We're good.
I mean, not all the cards are blatantly terrible, but, some are, and some are just weird things like memes like more dots or hitting Eriko a high society mostly because of the sun worship.
Gotcha.
Things that are funny, but not terrible. And then there are the ones that are terrible, like the Worgen Curse, Gilneas' most common STD.
Yeah, I can see that.
So what you can find that at cardcastgame.com. It's compatible with the Progenger Zizzy online Cards Against Vanity simulator.
What you need to do is add Kael'thas's Gaping Chest Wound.
There you go.
I might have to do that. I know I have a few Kael'thas.
Now you're going to be at 691. Now you're going to have to bump it up to something else crazy.
Yeah. So there you go. Go straight on to 700.
I'm always adding new cards.
Round it out to 700.
Whenever I have a good idea, and sometimes it's just a chain of jokes that work together, and then when you get multiple of them together in your hand, it just gets funnier and funnier. Like the well-hung jokes, which I won't go into detail on.
If I was going to do a WoW Cards Against Humanity card, I would do one that just said, "So please."
I don't get the reference.
And this is why I find it hilarious.
The hardest thing about that is getting the formatting right, especially on the call cards, because you have to leave those blanks specifically set up in a certain way, or they make no sense with how the normal response cards are formatted. So... But I'm getting into semantics that I'm sure some of the listeners find interesting, and others are going, why is he rambling on about this? The cards are funny, but you are not.
If you go to, or if you're 17 or over, definitely check out Cards Against Humanity.
Yeah.
You're being all responsible, Ben. You can take Ben out of GameStop, but you can't take GameStop out of Ben, I guess.
Please card responsibly.
Still essentially carding for video games at this point.
Yeah, pretty much.
Further Warcraft-related, but slightly more removed, is I've been playing Heroes of the Storm a lot this week. Get a couple matches in every day. And I've gotten up to player level 35. Slowly working my way to 40. Getting there. Mostly been playing as Nazebo, Murky, and Falstad with whatever else I need to cover it. I don't like playing supports. I played Rhaegar a bit this week. I'm okay with Rhaegar, but I don't like playing the support classes. And as much as I want to play Chen Stormstout, he is just not playable right now. He is just way too weak.
You know what? I actually saw John playing a match earlier tonight, and I think that you're kind of onto something. I mean, he totally destroyed Chen, but John, how was he?
How was who?
Chen.
He's dead.
Yeah.
He's very dead.
I mean, I heard that he was nerfed, like in the first patch after they went into beta. Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing that some combination of abilities was just really powerful, and they destroyed that utterly, and now he has nothing. And from watching Heroes of the Dorm, what I picked up is warriors, like Chen and that, they're the best warriors are ones that can start the engagement and follow through with a decent thorough put. And Chen has the okay engagement with his flying kick, but none of his other abilities really stack up after that.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason Ben brings up how Chen's doing is Ben came over. We frequently, before the show, will run next door, grab some drinks for the show, and, you know, talk things over, do some pre-show plotting, or just talk about Spider-Man or something. But I was in the middle of a Heroes game, so he's knocking on the door. I run over, I open the door, I just say, "Get in! I'm playing Heroes!" Run back to my computer. And he's watching me play for a little bit, and I get in a one-on-one fight. I'm playing Sylvanas with a Chen. I've definitely got him on the ropes, but he's very quickly getting away, and he manages to use an ability, and he evades, and he is now off the screen and heading for the place where he can heal up. So I fire Sylvanas' ultimate, the arrow, and it goes off screen. And I'm just waiting. I press it again to detonate it and killed him.
Nice.
Blind without even seeing it. And Ben was just like, his jaw just dropped and he goes, "Oh my gosh, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen."
Those are the best kills. When you just like the innate sense, you know exactly the direction he's heading because he's hurting. You kind of know how fast he's moving. You time the ability just right and boom, they die off screen. Oh, those are great feelings. Falstad's Hinterland Blast does that for me every so often. Just, it's like, I know they're running, I know they're there, aim, fire, and 3, 2, boom, 2 dead, yes!
That's like the equivalent of walking away from an explosion slowly in like an action movie or something.
Yeah.
Like,
it really was, Ben. You got really excited about that. It was a couple minutes later, I'm doing something else, and Ben's just like, it's just amazing. Like, he just brings it up again out of nowhere. Heroes is fun.
Yeah.
Heroes is a lot of fun.
Great game.
You need to add me on Battle Tag so when I'm on Thursday nights or Friday nights, I can join in because I need more people to play with. Playing alone solo queue is just, you can only carry so much as Murky.
Like a shell on your back.
Yeah.
He dies so easy. I've also played another MOBA-esque game called Awesome Knots on Steam. It's a 3v3 2D platformer version. Fun game. Highly recommend
it. Describe it as awesome?
Yes.
Not.
I would. Okay, picture League of Legends as a 2D. Picture League of Legends as a 2D platformer through the aesthetic of 80s cartoons.
That sounds all right. I could be down with that.
Yeah, look up Awesome Knots theme song on YouTube sometime. It is fun. It is ridiculous. There's a monkey in a jetpack that drops mines, a cowboy in space for some reason. I play the sniper chick Raylan, and they have they recently added a dragon named Nibs, who's incredibly fun as well. And finally this week, I went and saw Avengers.
Yay!
Actually, you know, just about the same time you guys were recording last week. Yay. So,
and then raced out of here, baffling the chat room with our immediate like, and that's a show, we're out!
Where did they go?
Away.
We went to Sokovia. Is the chat room going to let us talk Avengers spoilers at all? Because
No. We're not going to chat.
So he can't mention how it dies?
Nope. Good try, but no. Yeah. Anything else you've been up to? That's it?
Yep, that's it. I got nothing else.
John, how about you? I know part of what's been going on with your week.
Yeah, you do. Let's go ahead and first start by the fact that my WoW character has realized that her existence she needed to take it into her own hands. There's a like a monster truck going by outside right now. Just
yeah.
So everybody knows. It's distracting. so anyway, she decided she needs to take her existence into her own hands, and she decided that my continued subscription to WoW might be at a questionable point at this point. So she went over to the auction house and bought a couple WoW tokens.
All
so
right!
For the next 3 months, WoW is free to play for me. And I'm pretty excited about that because I'm happy to not be spending the money on it. The gold wasn't doing me any good. It was just accumulating, and that was about it. So.
And you are not at risk to not get another statue in the future.
Yeah, there you go. Statue status still in the green. So I'm going to at least be playing WoW for another 3 weeks. We'll see what happens after that. I have enough to buy more. I mean, why not? Again, gold's not doing me any good right now.
Yeah.
But I did actually play some WoW this week.
I know.
Shockingly enough.
It was so surprising.
Yesterday evening, it was getting close to raid time. I was trying to decide what I was going to do with my evening. I thought maybe I should return to raiding. And then I thought, well, why should I pick? We should let everybody pick. So I actually put a poll up online to see if I should return to raiding. And the overwhelming vote was yes, that I should. I don't think they chose properly. It wasn't what I voted for because I voted in my own poll. But they went ahead and said I should go. So I raided with you guys, sorta.
Mm-hmm. You were there.
You guys ran for about 2 hours, probably, right?
About, yeah.
I was there for 45 minutes.
Woo!
I have nothing nice to say about the raid experience last night. I don't have one nice thing to say.
We'll get into that in a minute here. Why don't you talk about everything else, and then we'll just swing back.
Okay. So, beyond that, I've been playing a lot of Heroes of the Storm. Been getting way into that. I unlocked Hero League. Woo! Tried that out. That's pretty cool, except that I constantly get put at the like last person to choose my hero. So that bugs me for a couple reasons. One, usually the people I want have been picked at that point. Two, it also means that my whole team has chosen at that point, so now the pressure's on me to choose what is going to go with the composition that they got to pick, right? So, like, everybody else picked a bunch of assassins and fun stuff, and now they're like, all right, we need a support and a tank. It's like, well, crap, I guess I got to pick a support or a tank. So I don't really get to play. I don't always get to play who I want to play.
What you do also, at that point, no, you just choose Gazlo, just because.
No. At that point, you just go, F it, Murky.
Yeah. This is happening. This is what you've all brought upon yourself.
You chose who I wanted to play, so F you. I'm having fun no matter what.
I'm going to give everybody a free tip because it was not immediately apparent to me. When you are at the character select screen, you can scroll. It's going to show a selection of heroes down at the bottom. You can scroll. There's different pages of heroes.
Oh.
There's a lot of empty space, and so I was like, this is weird. Does it only let you pick from, like, a certain pool? Like, I found it very confusing at first, because it was like, half of them were grayed out because I didn't own them. The ones that weren't grayed out were quickly disappearing, and I was like, man, it's not letting me pick from very many people. And then I saw them picking characters that weren't on the list that I was looking at, and I thought, this is really weird. It just was one of those weird UI decisions that they made that didn't make immediate sense to me, and then I figured out after I had already locked in my choice for that round and was sad about it. So that's my free tip. When you unlock Hero League, you can pick from all the characters.
It'll be last, but you can pick.
Yeah, exactly. If you've got my luck, you'll always be the last person picking. So that's been about it. Gaming-wise, I've been mostly playing Blizzard games that aren't WoW. But let's swing it back and talk about the little bit of WoW we played.
Woo!
So let's talk rating, Ben.
Okay.
You were there.
I was there. I would like to start off by saying Sunday, before you got to raid, last night, back on Sunday, we spent 2 hours wiping on Orgorger.
Oh, so you're saying the horrible experience I had could have been worse.
Yeah, but here's the thing. We started off last night by letting everybody know, hey, we're going to go do Gruul, and then we're going to work on Orgorger some more, instead of, going to the two bosses that we've beaten as well. Because we've killed Hans and Franz, Beast Lord, and Gruul, and we've killed Orgorger once, but it was kind of a fluke. It was one of those, like, everybody running around with our heads cut off, and we killed him. And then, you know what? On Sunday, we were doing okay, got him down to 2%, and then... Oh, no, that was the Thursday before. We got him down to 2%, and then we decided to, actually come up with the strategy instead. And that's what we worked on Sunday. Then some tweaks were made so that it's a little bit more orderly, and then that's what we were doing last night as well. But here's the thing. Last night, and... I mean, you texted me about this, so I'm going to totally speak for you, but it felt really dark and oppressive and just soul-sucking, right?
Yeah, it felt awful.
This is the beginning of the raid.
I've never had a worse time raiding than I did last night.
So my theory in it is that it's because we decided that we were going to work on Orgorger last night. That's my guess. But, it started out really at a really low point, unfortunately.
Yeah, so I got in, and let me kind of tell you what my perspective was coming in. It was like coming back to a team that is now bored of the content. Like, no longer is into what they're doing, is no longer... It is just, like, farm status. Like, the last weeks of Siege of Orgrimmar... But, like, with a bunch of people who were really tired and grumpy at the same time. Like, but we're also failing at the first fight. So it's like going into a raid where everything should be on farm status based on how people are acting and how, like, just meh everybody is about it. But then we're wiping on the first boss. Like, the trash in there is just awful. Like, everybody knows I already hate trash. So... Like, the trash in there is just atrocious. Like, as it was pulling, I'm like, I'm not fighting this trash, and I'm not even doing it to try and be funny or to come on the show and be like, oh, I skipped trash. I was just like, screw it. I can't even find the willpower to press a key on my keyboard. This is so just, like, the most boring, mundane trash in the world. Like, all of this feels awful. There was a cloud of gloom just hanging over everybody. So many people... Just felt like they didn't want to be there. And as a result, I kind of went in and I was like, yeah, I'm kind of excited to see it again. And I immediately dropped right back to where I was when I stopped raiding, which was right along with those same people of just, fun. I don't want to do this anymore. And it's the first time that I've ever, while I'm raiding, just been like, oh, I'm so bored. How far into this are we? And we were 30 minutes in. I made it 30 minutes before I was so bored I was checking the time. And I'm not saying this to just, like... I'm not even saying that this is, like, a criticism of Blizzard. I do think there are some issues with the content, but part of it was the players, too. And, like, I don't want to say that anyone on our raid team is bad or they're ruining the experience. Like, everybody gets in funks, but apparently everybody was in a funk last night. And, so...
Being someone who's been there, pretty much every other raid session that we've had, it was a funk last night. You could just feel it. It was palpable, like, completely. As soon as we started, I'm just kind of like, oh my god, ugh. So
yeah, like, it was odd. There was a part of me that was just like, are we at some point gonna just, like, rally and be like, let's go do something dumb and stupid just so that people don't want to, like, cry for the next hour and a half? But yeah, I ended up ducking out early because it is well known that I have a strong stance of if you're not having fun, don't play the game. And I was absolutely not having fun. So we got to the break and I was out of there. Another part of that, we were using group loot. I hate group loot. I understand why you're doing it. Like, I don't want to come into your raid that you've been doing for 2 months that I've been skipping and be like, you shouldn't do that. Obviously, that's going to give you the biggest benefit at this point. But as soon as I heard that, I was just like, ugh, really? Jeez. Like, I don't know. It was just awful. It was just an awful night. So that might be the last time I raid for a long while again. Yeah.
At least until the next raid tier when we go into it.
I don't know. I had hopes that maybe this content was going to be better, and I don't know. Maybe if we had gone a different path, maybe if we had done the fights that you'd been saying were fun, like, maybe I would have had a different perspective on the night, but... I also think, I don't know, I feel bad because now I feel like I'm calling out individual people and I shouldn't do that, but I'm going to say it anyway, so...
Oh, jeez.
I didn't...
Just like, use my name. You blame me for it all. I'm one of the raid leaders, so use my name.
Okay, you are one of the raid leaders, yeah. So I am blaming you. Okay, perfect.
All right.
I also feel like if everybody can sense that everyone is in a palpable bad mood, like, why would you push progression on that night? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, if everybody is in a dark place, why would you choose to send it into the darkest spiral imaginable? So, that's my opinion as an outside observer who's run with you once in 2 months. I don't think I should have any say whatsoever on what you do. I rolled on a piece of loot, and had I won it, I was going to give it to the other person who rolled because I knew I wasn't going to use it. So that's my worthless 2 cents, but it just didn't it did not gel with me last night.
Right now, I'm just picturing a little angel and devil on your shoulder. I'm just picturing seeing you going back and forth between the devil of the devil's going, yes, tear them a new one, rip into them, and the angel's going, no, they're your friends, they're there to help you, John. They're carrying you through this content as best they can. They're really trying their hardest. You just keep going back and forth from the whole, it was a pit of despair and terrible, but it wasn't anyone's fault, really.
Everybody on our raid team. I think everyone on our raid team is great. I have absolutely said that if I feel like I'm going to be the factor that brings people down, I won't be there. I've heard from other raid team members that it sounds like they're maybe stepping back because they're kind of feeling the same way. So I completely get it. I'm not trying to throw anybody on the raid team under the bus or anything like that. It just, as I was sitting there, I was like, I don't think anybody wants to be here, and decisions are being made that seem to continue to push people in that direction. So,
well, you know, I can say that it's one of those... We had a new strat. We wanted to try it. And we did for a very long time. But when we started the strat, we found out that there's a little bit more RNG in it than we knew of going into it. So then we had to adjust on the fly. And the thing is, though, when we were actually fighting Orgorger, we were making progress and doing better. I think our best attempt was getting down to about 20%, which, other than the, you know, 2% wipe and the kill that we've had... Using this strat, that's the best that we've gotten. Like, on Sunday, the best we did was, like, 40. So we're doing better in that first rolling phase and all that stuff. And that's one of the things of, we need to get a strategy down for it to kill him so that he is on farm. And that's why we stuck with the practice on him. Yeah, so
that makes sense. You know, like I said, these are just my perspectives as someone who this was their first night back.
Yeah.
And I certainly don't expect or think the raid should be tailored for me.
Oh, it never
from
is.
That perspective, I know. Hey, it was on group loot. It definitely wasn't tailored for me. Yeah. It was not great, but Ben, you also raided, so yes. Let's get your perspective.
Well, first off, DG, I wanted to comment. John doesn't have an angel and a devil on his shoulders. He's got a devil on one side, and on the other side, just a guy just kind of shrugging. Just,
I don't know where he is.
Best way to do it, I don't know. Don't ask
he's
me.
He's got the devil and one of the neutral aliens from Futurama. Tell my wife I said hello.
I've got a devil and a smiling devil. He gives pretty much the same advice, but in a nicer way.
That works.
Trust me, I'm in this. As far as raid team goes, and I don't want to get too much into this because I'm afraid I really will offend someone.
Just say it's John.
More underlying issues.
No, just say it's John, and he's not going to get offended.
Well, no, but no, because I'm not on your raid team. It's a different raid team. We run weekend raids, and I'm only really able to make Saturdays consistently. And they don't make progress on Saturday nights. It's like, we've actually been going backwards. We used to down like 3-4 bosses a night. Now we're down to like 1-2. And I don't know if it's people coming in or just people not caring, but we're just not making ground. And it's like, I can only raid on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. I'm not really huge into raiding, but I'm okay at it. I enjoy it somewhat. I like being with people. And it's like, well, the only upgrades I still need are on Blast Furnace, Iron Maidens, and Black Hand at this difficulty level. You know, it's just like, and we're not even getting to, you know, Flame Bender. Why am I even showing up? I totally understand the burnout. Mm-hmm. and how hard Blackrock just seems to be a pit of a black hole of despair and aggravation and.
Yeah,
I understand your drainedness.
Hey, John, would you believe me if I said that I actually enjoy Blackrock more than Throne of Thunder?
Yeah, because I think Throne of Thunder was awful.
Okay, good.
It's like taking the worst thing ever and being like, would you believe I like this more? Yeah, because it's the worst thing ever. It was the worst thing ever for a reason.
Now I didn't read Miss at current content. Never did, mm-hmm. So I can't give perspective on this. But I'm gonna ask you a question instead.
Okay.
Would you say that's because in Throne of Thunder, when you brick walled on a boss, you had no other option but to try and break through the brick wall? But no. In Blackrock Foundry, if you brick wall on a boss, you can go fight another boss that maybe you can down.
No, I would say it's because Throne of Thunder was horrible.
Yeah.
It's you have to 75... quantify what you mean by Throne okay. of Thunder was horrible.
It's 75 me. Miles of trash interrupted occasionally by a really bad boss fight.
Yeah, in all honesty, I was not a big fan of it at all. I've tried, you know, going through. I didn't find, like, most of the boss fights interesting at all. When you have a maze of purple glowy stuff on a purple floor, that's bad design. Bad. Right. Even if there's like a little
what
gap.
What would you say were the best bosses out of Throne? I will not say that you were wrong that the Throne of Thunder are bad bosses. No. What would you say are the best bosses out of Throne of Thunder?
The only good boss. No, the only good boss is Raiden. And I saw that during Warlords, you know, when I outgeared the whole content. The rest of the stuff, I did not enjoy any of those fights.
Okay, I haven't seen Raiden yet. I'd say the best bosses I've seen out of there are potentially the Twin Consorts. Ooh. For every reason other than their character design. And maybe Herodron, the Triceratops, Herodron.
Ooh. I liked the first boss.
If you take them out of context of how much trash is around them.
Well, the Triceratops is just a trash fight. You kill trash the entire time.
It's a trash fight after all the trash. Yes, I know. That's the worst part. I'm saying if you did have him after all that trash and the wind walkways and whatnot, it's an interesting fight. Good mechanics. I like it. The just a trash fight after nothing but trash, yeah, it gets old.
If you want a good dinosaur fight, fight Thok. That was a good fight.
Okay, I did do Siege as current. That was the only raid I got to do somewhat currently. Mm-hmm. I did Looking for Raid and Normal on that. Didn't get to the final boss. I did get Final Boss down in Normal too, but...
Guys, there was a whole dinosaur-themed thing in the middle of Mists of Pandaria. I don't know why, but it just hit me. I mean, I remember being excited about it at the time, but just how weird is that? Right in the middle of this story about pandas and evil war chiefs and raiding Orgrimmar, there's just this whole big dinosaur thing that happened.
Well, the trolls showed up and they brought their dino buddies. You know, they could have made it more detached. The raptor that got launched into space from Ishara shows up with space dinosaurs. Suddenly, dino saucers invading World of Warcraft. You know, Blizzard does not need a reason to throw at us what they throw at us. It just will happen at some point.
I'm just stuck on Dino dumb. Buddies, thinking that it's an 80s cartoon of little dinosaur friends.
It probably was. That's why I referenced dino saucers. Dinosaurs. Everything can we go back to an 80s cartoon as a reference, really?
Ben, what else did you think of Raid?
It was a very frustrating night. Very frustrating. Okay.
So I wasn't alone.
No.
I wasn't the only one. It wasn't me being a curmudgeon.
We worked on a strat.
People will think.
We improved with the strat, but we didn't succeed in everybody doing the strat, you know. And something that I really noticed, and I mean, I might be wrong on this, and this isn't like a dig on, you know, BlackRock Foundry or anything like that. It's just kind of an interesting, you know, perspective that I have. Our team, even though, you know, a majority of it is, of course, you know, podcasters, so, you know, people who actually play World of Warcraft and have been talking about it for a while, we still have a lot of other people on the team as well, you know, friends, family, everything like that, people from our guild and everything. So we have all different types of levels. I mean, we got people who've been raiding since the very beginning. We have people who are just starting to raid. I mean, it's one of those things where we really are that friends and family group. Like, heck, some of the podcasters with us are just starting to raid. You know, I'm not like trying to single friends out and all that stuff. But anyways, that's all beside the point. To me, even though, you know, we're normal raiding now, it feels like the whole concept behind flex mode and everything like that didn't actually carry over like it was supposed to.
I completely agree with this statement.
Yeah, a lot of, you know, the mechanics and everything, while they're interesting and neat, it doesn't seem like that normal raiding is really geared towards friends and family anymore, where flex mode was. I know that Tetsemi had talked about it last night for a little bit, and I talked to him a tiny bit today. You know, we were talking about how the fact that, you know, with, like, Siege of Orgrimmar, some people, you know, who are, like, really dedicated or really into it and everything can totally, you know, outgear the content faster and easier, and then you can bring those friends and family along. Whereas with this, it's all individual responsibility. It's all mechanics. There's no way that you can outgear that and, you know, just kind of have fun, run around, and get together.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think there's actually three things in here, and you kind of touched on most of them with what you just said, but it's been my thought as well. I think normal doesn't feel like it's on par with what flex mode used to be, and that's what it's supposed to be. Flex mode was supposed to become normal. I think it feels a little harder than what flex mode should be. The other thing I think is we're getting to a point where we're getting too mechanics heavy on bosses.
Yeah.
It's almost like Blizzard is too afraid to do a repeat or something that's too much like something that's been done before, that now there's got to be a million different things. Like, you look at the strategy for the opening boss, for an opening boss in the current raid content, and that sheet is as complicated as, like, final bosses from early vanilla and, you know, Burning Crusade, you know, like the ultimate bad guy. They're on par mechanically speaking. Mm-hmm. And I feel like Blizzard needs to get out of that fear of, oh no, what if we make something that has already been done before or is not super complicated and a whole new dance to learn. And I don't know if the solution is when you increase difficulty, you add mechanics, because then the people who want a challenge and want something crazy and new would get it. And the people who are just there to kind of raid with friends and all of that maybe don't have to worry so much about it. Like,
I would counter on that. If you make the increase in difficulty, add mechanics, the problem is that makes it harder for people to go up in difficulty levels. You know, say you're really enjoying raiding at the current normal level. You're getting into the swing of things. You got all the fights down and cool. Now I'm going to look for Heroic Guild, get in the Heroic Guild. And suddenly this new mechanic completely neutralizes your class in this fight. And then you go to this fight and the mechanic, it's just something that you don't process well. because that's the problem for some people.
You're saying it would make it more difficult?
I'm not saying just more difficult. I mean, it might actually literally keep people out of raiding higher level difficulties because now suddenly, you know, you've done this fight 20 times on a lower difficulty, and now you feel confident enough to move to an upper level, and your timing is completely off. You can't get adjusted to it, and the raid guild says, sorry, you're just not working out, and kicks you.
Well,
and you go for 3 weeks, and it's just...
Let's simplify this, okay? John, because I've seen, you know, a lot of raiding from Burning Crusade to Wrath to Cataclysm, you know, a little bit at least there, to Mist to here. DG, how long have you raided overall? I know you said that you didn't do anything at level last expansion except for Siege a little bit. Were you playing and doing things like, say, ICC or anything Burning Crusade?
Yes, I was raiding in ICC.
Okay.
That was like the first. I was a tank in ICC for my guild,
mm-hmm.
and did some raiding in Kata.
Okay.
And with a group, once they made crossovers kind of happen, and my guild fell apart during Kata, so in this I was kind of soloing, and now I'm back into the raiding game. So. Okay. I was more of a Wrath. I started pretty much raiding in Wrath.
Okay. Well, let me look at this. There's two different scenarios that I kind of thought of. Okay. So in, say, Burning Crusade, one of the biggest things that you need to do was not stand in the poop. That was the mechanic.
I would argue that's the base mechanic in Black Rock Foundry.
Yeah.
It
that's
only
where I'm going.
Like, in Burning Crusade.
Yeah, let's look at it this way. Okay, Burning Crusade. We fought Gruul. Yay, it's Gruul! You know, I actually really enjoyed that fight. That was the first raid that I ever went to. Mechanics in that. Don't stand in the cave-in, and don't stand next to someone with the shatter, right?
Yep.
And then he grew.
Fast.
Like, that's it. Now we fight Gruul. We have don't stand in the cave-in. That's great. Don't stand next to people in the shatter. That's great. Make sure that your group is split and that you put the flame scythe on one group twice and then the other group twice and, you know, switch it back and forth. Watch out for the overhead strikes. And when he goes crazy, definitely watch out for the overhead strikes there. Oh, and if the cave-ins are in a spot where you can't actually evenly distribute your groups, it's a wipe. Kind of see
mechanics.
Where I'm going there? Yeah. You add more mechanics to it to make it more difficult, but if I'm someone who is, you know, maybe not the most self-aware with where I'm standing or what I'm doing with the raid, when it's time to move, if I'm not, you know, the raider, you know, like if I'm, say, friends and family person or something, I'm not going to be as fast on the draw as everyone else, and I could die a lot easier with that. I know that sometimes when we're doing the Gruul fight in Blackrock, when the shatter mechanic happens, when it's time for like the blue side to get the swipe, all of them are shattered and there's only like one or two people there. There's RNG thrown in as well. I mean, there's so much more that they're doing, adding more mechanics, making things more difficult. And while, you know, I enjoy challenges, I enjoy playing, I think that they are getting to the point where too many mechanics is really starting to kind of steer people away from some of the especially some of the easier earlier bosses.
I'm not going to disagree with you on that, but I know exactly where that came from. It came from late Lich King, early Kata, tanks going, well, we got nothing to do. We put on our gear, we stand there, let the boss hit us, and occasionally we swap. And that was been the tank's complaint. Like, all is in Wrath, because I've heard the stories of how tanks had it in Burning Crusade. I was playing in Burning Crusade, but I didn't get to max level till Wrath. Mm-hmm. And I heard how the tanks had it. You know, we had to control groups, we had to, you know, mark CC, we had to do all this stuff. And that went away in Wrath of the Lich King. And all the tank had to do was, well, occasionally we have to move a boss to a certain position, and we have to swap at a certain amount of stacks. And in Lich King and Kata fights, that was all the tank really had to do. We swap at this many stacks. We move the boss here, we tank the boss here, and we swap at this set. Or you tank this boss, I tank that boss. And that's it. And so now these mechanics like Flame Strike on Gruul, a perfect example. That's a tank mechanic added in, so the tanks have something to do other than stand there and swap. oh, now you have to move between this group and this group on the flame strike to ensure that you don't die. And they're trying to find ways to make tank gameplay interesting. Mm-hmm. And the healers then go, well, we are keeping the tank up, we're keeping the party up, but we're not really doing anything else, and we just don't stand and stuff. Well, now we add this mechanic to try and give healers something to do. So they're trying to vary up how the roles are playing, and the only way they can do that is by adding a mechanic that is directed at this group. But if they don't get their, if they can't fulfill that role, then you kind of have the problem.
A cascading effect.
It falls down onto the DPS. And then the DPS are going, well, why do we have all these mechanics to deal with? Well, you're not actually supposed to be really worrying about half of them now, because that's a tank mechanic and that's a healing mechanic. And the only reason you're dealing with it is, well, your raid comp's low on healers, so you have to be more careful about this mechanic or that mechanic. And I think that's the only... That's what I see.
I'm going to say this. First of all, tanks have had more to do... But fights being a tank swap, and that's it, has been a criticism as late as Mists of Pandaria. I mean, it's how still often happened. Do we make
yes,
the...
Yes, I know.
Yeah, how often do we make the joke in Mists of Pandaria of... Hey, can you guys maybe come up with something other than a tank swap for us to do? Because that's on every single fight, and that's the only thing on every single fight. Right. But, I mean, further than that, like, let me also point out this. So, DG, you just said you raided a little bit in Lich King, but really kind of the start was Lich King / Wrath. Ben, your start was Burning Crusade. Gruul was your first raid. Mm-hmm. My first raid was Molten Core and Vanilla. Between the three of us, all three of us have different starting points for raiding. We all have a different background of raiding. I did pretty much zero raiding in Cataclysm. Other than that, I've raided every expansion. Ben's raiding experience is different. DG, I'm sure your raiding experience is different. If we pulled everybody in the chat room, I would bet that we probably come up with a different list of who's done what and who's participated in what. Mm-hmm. So to me, the idea of not being able to reuse mechanics or being worried that something goes back to something that's already been done before. And I mean, I'm not saying I want to go into a fight and have it be exactly Kael'thas's fight. You know, I don't want to see just a complete rehash, but I don't feel like they need to get so insane with mechanics if the reason is, you know, like, well, we need to keep evolving and we need to keep making it better, because I don't think it's getting better. Right. And they might be adding these mechanics for healers, for tanks, for things like that, but it's not making for a better experience overall. The tanks are still complaining about every fight just being a tank swap. The healers are still complaining about healer stuff. Sorry, healers, I don't know much about you. You're a strange, mysterious unicorn. You're wonderful and beautiful. You're great. Thank you.
Love you.
And DPS are complaining because there's too many mechanics. So I think the focus needs to be, are these fights fun? And I don't think there's enough fun fights in the game necessarily anymore. Go ahead, Ben.
No, I can go with you on that. I mean, DG, when you were talking about, you know, tank swaps and mechanics and everything like that, the first one that popped to mind was in Heimal, Tektis. So one tank holds the boss for a while. Then when the boss splits, then they get to hold, you know, the other tank gets to hold one too. Meanwhile, DPS are dancing all over the freaking place.
Oh, yeah. I've done the fight.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. It's like, okay, let's throw mechanics that'll just, you know, kill you. And even on top of that, here's more RNG that'll put you in a situation that you just cannot get out of without dying. God.
Melee? Who plays melee anymore? Really?
Plus, threat used to be a mechanic that was a thing that everybody had to worry about. But
Vanilla and Burning Crusade, that was definitely a mechanic that tanks was the other tank mechanic was threat.
Well,
and that almost went away in Wrath.
Almost.
It's still there.
But I will also say that the boss fights are just too long. I mean, for as complicated as the dance for Gruul is, I feel like that fight goes on for what feels like another eternity after you've hit the point where it's clear that you know the dance. You know, I feel like there's a certain point in a boss fight where you get where it's like, we've been through the pattern of movement and what needs to be done at least twice. It's clear we know it, but then you spend another 3 minutes just hitting the thing and continuing to do it. And I just don't get bored during the fights. Like, that's one of my biggest problems is with Gruul last night. I mean, we wiped a couple of times from there was some bad RNG. I mean, on our side, there was a point where we were standing on a sliver of a hallway between the big collapses. And then he starts slamming right in the middle. And mm-hmm. that was the time when we needed to get the fiery sickle on us. So it was like, oh, okay, well, I guess this is just going to be death then.
Yeah.
But there was still a time, even on the victory one, where I'm sitting there and I'm just like, okay, we're doing it. We're clearly going to win. Everybody's at like full health. Everybody's doing the dance. Nobody's dead. And we've still got like 30% to go on the boss.
There's a good question. I want to know now, how long did boss fights take at level? Because I can't remember for the life of me how long fights took when we were running ICC. I don't remember how long fights were in Dragon Soul. I don't remember even how long fights were in Throne of Thunder or Siege of Orgrimmar at this point.
They felt too long in Siege of Orgrimmar as well, because that was a complaint I had during Siege. But here's the thing. They might, like, I would be curious about the numbers on this. I really would. Like, I would find that super interesting. But Siege of Orgrimmar and then this expansion, Warlords, are the first times where I've noticed it. So even if the numbers were pinpoint and Blizzard could say, look, it is exactly the same across the board.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they said that, this is the point in time where I'm noticing it and just being like, man, this fight is just a grindy mess. And that's not to say that every raid before was perfect. There were fights that weren't wonderful. I think I do remember, you know, there would be times where we'd be working on patchwork and it would just be like, because you're just doing the same thing nonstop for patchwork. There's not a lot of nuance to that fight.
Yeah. Straight but DPS. That's it.
For those fights, the reason I didn't get bored is because I was trying to beat personal bests. Like, usually by the time I was getting to the point where, oh, I'm getting bored, then it became this challenge of, will we get the achievement? Will we, you know, can I do this? What's going to happen with this? There were other things that kept me interested in those fights that I'm just not feeling in the more current stuff.
Yeah. Well, let me counter some of that, what you just said, by saying, are we under-geared?
I don't know. Are we under-geared? I haven't been raiding for 2 months, and I had a higher eye level than some of you, so yeah. I don't know what that means.
That could be it.
But at the same time, though, from what I've seen, you know, elsewhere, we're plenty geared. You know, most of our members, if not all, are, you know, at the level that we should be at. But then you look at, like, things like, say, Ask Mr. Robot, Warcraft Logs, things like that. I'm like, oh, well, at your gear level, this is happening or this isn't happening and all that stuff. So that seems to vary as well. But then, you know, Orgorger specifically, that's the first boss in the dungeon journal. That's where you're supposed to start? I know that in Blackrock, you can go anywhere, and that's fine. But that's where you're supposed to start? It doesn't make sense. It makes just as much sense as the dogs back in Mogoshan Vaults. You want to talk about mechanics? Holy crap, that's mechanics. Yeah, the tanks, that was definitely a tank fight. They had to make sure that they're tanking the right two together at the right time and all this. Meanwhile, DPS and healers are all worried about everything else that's going on the floor. You know, you're losing space of this giant room because there's so much crap everywhere.
Can I make a confession?
Of course.
I still don't know the strat to that fight.
Just kill it.
I've done it. I've been in there. I have faked it every single time. I have no idea. There's a bar that fills and does something. It's all very exciting and full of action. I have no idea how any of that works. I can tell you the strats for the other fights. That one, I'm like, I don't know.
You know what? I wouldn't fault you for that. I have this experience too a lot where it's like, well, I'll be on I've never done this fight before. Raid leader explaining fight. I start zoning out, reading Tumblr, come back in and go, okay, we're going to pull now. I get ready. And like, I didn't listen to a word he said, and I still have no idea how this fight's supposed to go. Uh-oh. But then between deadly boss mods and experience at this point, because even though I started in Wrath, I went and ran, even in Wrath, I went and did Vanilla, Burning Crusade, every single raid. You know, everything other than, you know, classic Nax, I've done it. I've seen the boss fights. I know the mechanics. Every fight at this point, nothing is new. Nothing is surprising to me. It's like, oh, it's a little bit of a variation on this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this. And it seems like that's why they keep adding these mechanics in, because experience, people who've done every single fight in the game at this point, if you've run every dungeon and every raid currently in the game, you've seen pretty much every possible mechanic they can throw at you at this point.
Well,
or some variation of it.
Two things. Next expansion, the first like end boss for the tier is going to be a boss called The Mechanic, and it uses everything that's been in the game all in one fight.
Is everything. He a goblin?
Yep, he's a goblin slash gnome. Okay. He's a gnomelin. Oh, that's wrong.
That's terrifying. Just trying to picture. He has he'd have to have like Gorfine's face, Terran Gorfine's face from Black Temple, that like weird painted on human face on the Night Elf model.
Oh, horrible!
He just has something looking like that. A boss rush type event where you go into an arena. There's no trash. And bosses just show up, and you don't know which boss you're going to get.
That'd
Your group
great.
Has to just immediately change on the fly and be ready for any mechanic in the game. I think that would be a friggin' blast.
Just a series of rooms, and each room is a different boss room. As soon as you walk in, you go, oh, I recognize this.
Oh, it's Ragnaros.
Oh, hey, Rags. Do you know how mad people would be when they got the Klaxi guys? And we're like, Ted, quick, find the page on the forums that has the order that we have to kill them in.
Oh, thank God, we got Klaxi now. What's the next room? Sindragosa. Oh, God dang it, my ears!
But see, that's the kind of thing, with no trash, with it just being a boss rush, that's the kind of thing that I think groups would actually have a lot of fun with.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think a lot of groups would have this, like, whole attitude of, like, it would just be chaotic enough in the fun way. Like, I don't think, depending on how you gear it and what its purpose is and where it falls, like, I don't think this should be a raid tier. It should be a thing that you can just do as a dumb thing. You should get something for doing it. But I would have fun doing that. And, like, if a raid team was having a bad night where it's just like, oh, we hate everybody right now, like, that would be a fun thing to queue in where it could just be like, oh, we're going to down some bosses. It's going to be dumb fun.
Yeah. So. Well, no, it's like at BlizzCon when they did, like, the live raid. Remember when those used to be, like, a whole lot of fun to watch because you never know what it was going to be? They'd have, like, bosses doing different types of mechanics than they actually did, or they'd just be like, oh yeah, we put Ragnaros and Kael'thas together, let's see what happens.
The year before Cataclysm, where they just threw all the Cata dungeon bosses at them at once, scaled up to raid level outside of Ogrimmar.
Yeah
that was great. It's like, we have no idea what these guys even do. They're getting chained together by the dude from Blackrock Descent. Just, you know, the guy from Stonecore is going, break yourself upon my body.
Yeah, something like that would be cool.
Blizzard's like, okay, we're going to take pity on you and move you on to the next stage. And they just throw all the dragons ever in the game at them at once.
Yeah, stuff like that. Oh my gosh, that'd be fun.
Yeah, Mega Hogger was from that period as well.
Yep.
Mega Hogger.
Yeah, going back to talking about, like, the strats and everything like that, like, before the poll, we kind of have an inside joke with our raid with Ro. Ro is very good, very meticulous with, you know, explaining fights and everything. And sometimes he goes, like, really in depth. And it's a lot of fun because, you know, then we just start, you know, not paying attention or drifting off as well. Like, cause, you know, for the most of us, a lot of us, do know, you know, the strats cause we've read about it on the forums or whatever, but there's always one or two who really have no idea what's going on. And, you know, Ro's great and helps them with that. Other times we do the quick and dirty version, which is me, which is basically just saying, okay, you do this, this, and this, boom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Quick,
because
quick and dirty, that's what I need
because
in my life.
What Ro will do is, you know, he'll talk about, you know, the mechanics for everybody so that, you know, they're aware of what's going on. And that's great. I say, you know, I'm like, okay, John, you're the melee. This is what you need to worry about. Meanwhile, yeah. I leave out like 10 different mechanics that are going on that he'll never see. It's just one of those things where, again, too many mechanics are starting to get into the raids. I think that that is turning into what it is.
I think raids need a point where you can just kind of also have some fun. Like, and I think sometimes we get too caught up in the challenge of it. I mean, I notoriously complained about Spoils of Pandaria for a little while. And then Alec Haz, who was one of our raid leaders, made the mistake of saying, only I and Tetsemi are allowed to open boxes. Which he didn't know me well enough to know that that's never a thing that you should say to me, because I then proceeded to start opening boxes like a crazy person. Mm-hmm. Which Tetsemi liked. Like, thankfully, I was on Tetsemi's side. I would be every off this time. Raid team if I was on Alakaz's side. But Tetsemi took me over on his side, and he not only supported my my constant box opening habit, but he encouraged it. And there's even a point where I wasn't opening boxes, and he was like, "John, where's the boxes?" So, but I mean, like, that's fun. I was doing it at a point where I knew it wasn't going to wipe the group. It was a fun little thing that Tet knew what I was doing. I knew what I was doing. We were laughing about it ourselves. And it slowly kind of became something that the raid knew about. Same thing with, I would say, in the previous raid tier, where you get the ability where you explode and you send everybody flying around you. Like, the second that happens, I look for Ben,
mm-hmm.
and I run after Ben to blow him up.
And I run away.
Because that's what that mechanic's for. That mechanic is for me to have fun. And I think there needs to be opportunities like that. Fights where you know you're going to come out okay, maybe not for bosses, maybe for bosses, where it's just a chance for you and your raid team to laugh and have a good time together. You know, it's almost like running a D&D campaign. Like, you don't want it to just be room after room of... Mm-hmm. like fight after fight after fight after fight, where people are barely making it out alive and constantly having to rest. Like, sometimes you just want to have a good time. And I mean, look at places like Karazhan and the chess event. Like, Blizzard has in the past put in these things where it's just like, you know what, here's just a dumb fun thing to do. And I feel like there's no reason why raids can't be more full of stuff like that, to kind of keep people's spirits up and morale up as they're going through and fighting the legitimately challenging bosses.
Yeah. Okay, I was thinking this earlier, too, on that same vein. Do you think, 50% of the bosses in a raid have to be semi-comedic? Like, they have to have, some way you can find them funny? Just like Dalithria Dreamwalker. She's a sleeping dragon in the middle of the raid who occasionally you have to go into her dreams to save, and you're healing her. You know, you have the dialogue from, you know, Bloodwing or Plaguewing in ICC. You have Cho'Gall talking to himself in Bastion of Twilight, and the fairly effeminate Twilight Dragon in there as well. You know, you have these things that you can find the humor in. And in Blackrock, what? You have Hans and Franz, who talk like they're going to pump you up in there. That's it.
Honestly, you know,
everyone else is just these long, drawing voice. Okay, maybe the train boss too, little bit. But then train just feels like a prolonged trash fight, and it doesn't feel like a boss at all.
Honestly, like Hans and Franz, there's a part of me that doesn't even want to fight him because they seem so dumb. Like, I legitimately dislike that. Like, and I'm a person who likes those skits. During Karazhan, I think Ben and I used to do a riff on Hans and Franz.
Oh, probably.
But, like, as soon as it became a boss, I was just like, okay, so this is a joke. So if I ever wipe to this, I should be embarrassed and go home.
That's what you said about the chess event. If we ever wipe, we have to uninstall WoW and not play it again.
Yeah. That's
and
true.
Then we wiped on it once.
And we kept going because it was a fluke.
I
don't know. I just don't like that stuff. Like, it doesn't have to be funny or try to be funny. I don't think Hans and Franz is funny. But I just think that, like, funny doesn't make a bad encounter fun. Like, not saying that Hans and Franz is a bad encounter because I haven't done it and most people say they really like that fight. Great.
I do.
Mechanically, it's a fun fight. It shouldn't be fun because it's Hans and Franz and it's a parody of a Saturday Night Live skit.
Well, I really shouldn't tell you about the Wayne's World fight. That's at the end.
You just got to say party on, and then that means he's done. He just drops loot. He's like, exactly. All right, show's over.
You give him some donuts.
Yeah.
Sorry, DJ, you were going to say something?
Armed with a...
Yeah. I was trying to come up with a way to work the Iron Horde, party time!
Yeah,
well, couldn't come up with it.
They are metal.
I'd just be like, yep, I'm done, thanks.
No, I do kind of agree. I mean, let's look at some of the stuff that's, you know, has been put in that some would say is just like a loot pinata or whatever, just something fun. Like the chess event, it was something different, something fun, and it totally broke you out of the whole, like, you know, entire we're raiding this whole place, you know, mentality. ICC had the boat, which that was a fun fight.
Yep.
Granted, it was a little challenging at first if you didn't know exactly what was going on, but it was fun. And now you can solo it, which is weird, but that's beside the point.
You can solo it in 2 seconds.
I know.
Because otherwise it would just be locked out from you.
Oh, yeah.
Entirely. Like the rest of ICC.
Yeah, but like if you think about it too, like even in what was it, the trial of the whatever of the Crusader champion, whatever the raid was, I always mix those up. Why do they have to name it so similar? But like when you got to fight Jiraxis, I loved that fight every time because just Jiraxis. The intro was good, and then it was a good fight. I mean, there wasn't a whole lot going on with it again mechanically, but it was a lot of fun.
Are you saying you actually liked an RP before a fight?
Yes, because it was a good chance for raid teams to be like, no, don't do it. Oh, no, the horror. Or just quote the thing along with
you
that.
You liked Wilfred Fizzlebang, Master Summoner. You serve me now, demon. Trifling gnome, you face Jiraxis, Eridar Lord of the Burning Legion.
You've got it memorized.
Yes, I do.
All right.
Like, what about XT? I love that.
New toys! I like XT.
No.
That's one of my favorite fights. I love XT.
So.
Yeah. I mean, and the best thing about that is, again, not a ton of mechanics. It's essentially, stay away from people. Kill the adds. Don't kill the heart unless you're going into, heroic.
So what BlackRock Foundry is missing is good, funny voice acting for, you know, more than Hans and Franz. If Orc Orchard talked in a funny snarf voice from Thundercats, maybe you'd like him better.
No, I would hate him more.
That would not help that encounter at all. No. Not one bit.
No, not at all. But, I mean... You know, we keep coming back to it. I keep saying it. I keep pointing it out. It's the mechanics. There's nothing, you know, in the middle that it's, to put it in more, you know, touchy-feely terms, it's almost like, I mean, Heimal definitely didn't have one, but it's almost like as we're going through BRF, there's really no soul like there was in some of the previous raids.
Yeah, that's a good way to say it, because I think when you look at the mechanics for older fights, and especially if you look at a really solid raid like Ulduar, you see a lot of the mechanics are directly tied to the boss in a really, like, logical way. Sometimes nowadays it just feels like they're mechanics for mechanics' sake. Like, I don't know, we heard you like mechanics, so we put some mechanics with your mechanics.
Why does Flamebender summon both fiery swords and fiery dogs?
So...
What's the connection
But
there?
You look at something like XT, and it's like, okay, I fight him in the middle of a junkyard. He summons robots out of the piles of junk. And that repairs him. You look at Thorim. You've got this cool battle in the arena that he's making you fight while other people try to go around... to attempt to break him free of this brainwashing that's going on, because he's supposed to be a guy that you're rescuing. Like, a lot of the mechanics are really built into the story of the character. And that's another thing that I think is lacking, and this kind of reflects with Hans and Franz. A lot of times raids, it's just like, I don't know, we put in a thing. Like, here's a thing that's from the... We took this model, and now it's a boss, so fight it. And when you put in a clearly joke, like, set of NPCs like Hans and Franz. Like, there's no interesting lore tied to that. They're a joke.
Like, there is interesting lore tied to them, actually. They're outcasts that went wandering and found strength in the jungles.
Yeah, their name is Hans and Franz. I don't care.
Their names are Hansgar and Franzok.
It's a joke.
Abbreviate to Hans and Franz.
And, like, it's just random. Like, the most interesting bosses in that whole raid is Groll, because it's a callback to something that existed before. And the final boss, because he's an actual warlord, and hey, that's supposed to be why we're here. Whereas they had a perfectly good character that they introduced during the garrison quest that would have fit perfectly in the raid that they kill off during the garrison quest and isn't in there. They had an interesting lore character that could have been a part of the raid that they didn't do anything with. So I think story is also important, and I think it gets overlooked in raid tiers.
We could have had lots of interesting things they could have done. They could have, you know, we're in Pack in Time, for crying out loud. Why are we not fighting the past version, alternate versions of Varrock Sourfang?
Because he's cool.
Exactly. But this is the evil alternate universe version. He's got a mustache.
You're not prepared for alternate history Sourfang.
It'd be alternate history Illidan. We may still see him for all I'm hearing.
So, anyway, Ben, what else have you been up to in WoW?
Actually, I was going to keep this going and just make that the round table and be done with the show.
Oh, okay, well, let's keep pretending then.
Well, I think it's a little too late.
Oh, okay. We'll touch on what we had, but I think that was better than what we could have done.
Yeah, well, I mean, just... And that's kind of the hard thing, because, you know, I have raided through a lot of the content, barely any Cataclysm, and, you know, I didn't really want to say it on this show, because I really want to try to stay upbeat and positive, and, I mean, first and foremost, I'm still enjoying playing WoW, for the most part, but it's the fun that I'm going out and finding myself, you know, like I'm mount collecting and, you know, doing stuff like that and everything, pet battling. I enjoy the time that I spend with my raid team, but like I said, the raids feel kind of soulless compared to some of the stuff that's come before. And I'm really trying to figure out if it's just nostalgia or if it is, you know, just what they offered before for us, you know?
Yeah.
Or is it just, we're getting,
I don't know. It's just weird. Like, when I think back to what we've done, there was something that just felt so much grander about what we were doing before versus what we're doing now. Like, and it's easy to do because it's a one-to-one, although the scenario and situation around it is different. I look at Groll, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the first time we fought Groll, and this is way back in Burning Crusade, you go into this massive cavern. And he already looks like a big hulking behemoth that you gotta fight. And everybody runs in, and you're in this giant, just like domed structure. And as you fight him, he gets bigger. Like, you're already looking at him like, this is a big boss. And then he grows throughout the fight, mm-hmm. and to where his head is almost at the ceiling if you let it go long enough. And he's knocking everybody around, and everybody's flying off in all these different directions and running in, and, compare that to going into a relatively small room, put two markers on the ground, split the group, run in, stand in essentially one spot except when you have to get out of the stuff, and DPS him down. And occasionally you get knocked back a little bit, and you kind of have to move and be aware of where you are, and then move back in. And it just feels so watered down and uninteresting by comparison. And it's like that when I think of fights going back and forth, there's just something that always felt more grand about the other fights. And I just don't know what the difference is there. And like you said, I don't think it's nostalgia. Like, I think if you showed a video of people fighting original Groll versus current Groll, I think most people would think original Groll seemed better. I would think, but nostalgia can sometimes really cloud your perception.
Maybe it's just challenges getting in the way of actually having fun. Things can be challenging and fun, but I think the challenge has risen too high, matched to the fun level. People are trying to go up to the mythic level rather than bringing, you know, keeping the mythic up there and then lowering it down. It's filtering down too hard. Because when I think of mythic raiding, I don't think of it as fun. I think of it as rewarding.
It's a job.
Certain people enjoy that. But yeah, I don't think of it as fun.
It's a job. You log in, you play for 10 hours, you maybe get something to eat halfway in there, you go to sleep, you come back in the next day, log in, do the same thing. And while for some people that's rewarding, that's fulfilling, and that is their game, and Blizzard is great with giving everybody their game. You know, they have mythic raiding, they have regular raiding, they have too hard raiding for people who are supposed to be flexible and friends and family. But, you know, there's PvP out there, there's, you know, pet battles, there's a lot of stuff in this game. So, you know, when people come to you and say, like, yeah, there's nothing for me to do, that means that the content that's made specifically for them is not enjoyable. And I'm worried that because of the DJ, I think you said it perfect, like the trickle-down effect. They're tuning things for Mythic, at least it seems that way. And, I mean, granted, this is coming from someone who, I'm not running Heroic, I'm not running Mythic, I'm just running with my friends, and we're just going in there to have fun. It seems like it's tuned too high for us. Granted, there's going to be some teams that, you know what, they can go in there and just fly through it. Guess what? That's what Heroic is for. It's still tuned too high, there's too many mechanics, and it's just not, it's not Siege of Orgrimmar. Just like when LFR was put in the game, Dragon's Hole, the LFR that was for Mogoshan wasn't the same. They made it a little bit harder. The first one for this, they made it a little bit harder. I mean, it's just one of those things where either you have to iterate from, you know, the assumption that this person's been playing since vanilla, so obviously we have to make things harder for them, or let's make it impenetrable for people who are brand new to this to play, because we're just throwing so many mechanics at them and there's no fun aspect.
I have an interesting thought on bosses, and tell me if you think that this is a fitting analogy. So if you ask somebody who's in like the movie or television show industry and they do special effects, they'll tell you that the biggest compliment that you can give them is, I couldn't tell it was a special effect. I kind of feel like fights in raids should apply to that same thing. Mechanics fighting a boss, I feel like they've become too transparent. It's like bad CGI. You know, it's like Spider-Man jumping over the buildings and he looks like a wavy rubber man as he's jumping. Like, you can tell and it takes you out. And like, I look at New Gruul and it's like all I see is mechanics and this very rigid, like, stand here, move here, do this, do this. And I see it as mechanics, not as we're going to go in there and we're going to fight Gruul. Like, we're going to go in and we're going to move here at this point and here at this point, and we're going to do this, and I'm going to go through my rotation. And all of a sudden, it's gone from what I remember to being fighting bosses to now just like doing mechanics. And so for me, I feel like it's gone from the shift of like not noticing the special effects to only seeing the special effects.
Yeah. I can see that. As an example, let's pull it back to BlackRock. Now keep in mind, I haven't done the entire raid. I've only done, I think, two of the LFRs for it, like once each. From what I've seen on that, the only boss that it feels like I'm actually fighting the boss, to me at least, is my favorite encounter that I've had in there, which is Hansy, who I always forget the name, but call him Hansy.
Hansy.
It's an awesome boss. I have so much fun.
Gormok?
Sure, whatever. Big rock guy, he grabs you, like little hands pop up from the ground. I mean, it makes sense, it's fitting, and it's not like way too much is going on. I really enjoy that fight because of that. You know, it has a slight nostalgia feel with Kolagarn from Olduar, and John, that fits with you. When you're fighting him, guess what? You kill one of his hands, it turns into living rock things. Holy crap. He shoots lasers out of his eyes. Oh my gosh!
Cro-Mag. You know, it's name's Cro-Mag.
Cool, Cro-Mag.
We call him Hansy.
Yeah, his name's Hansy because, you know, he's the Hansy. But it's, you know, you got something there. It's it's not a mechanics based fight. It's a holy crap, let's kill this guy fight. I mean, yeah. DG, in your raiding experience, like, are you kind of seeing what John's saying? Did you ever feel that way, that it was just like, I'm taking down this boss as opposed to battling all these different mechanics?
You know, I honestly, in raids, I'm not even really thinking much about each fight or who I'm fighting. It's there. I'm there because I want to be with the people I'm raiding with, generally. I haven't done LFR yet this expansion. And I'm probably going to have to start doing that just to get my legendary done, because having such, you know, brick wall attempts in actual raiding. But I enjoy being with the people.
Yeah.
So am I fighting the boss or the mechanic? I hardly notice either way. All I know is that the boss isn't dying as much as I'd like, so...
because it's taking too long. My gear level is not
going up. I'm enjoying my time, but everyone else is getting really stressed out. And when everyone is getting stressed out around you and you're there to enjoy the time with people, it starts to make you stressed out. And I think Blackrock has been very, very stressful for a lot of people.
Yeah.
And so fighting the boss for fighting the mechanics, you know, that's like saying in PvP, are you fighting the player or are you fighting their abilities? And I don't know if there's really a clear line you can draw for some of those.
Oh, I'd say so. For PvP, it's definitely more fighting the person, because while they have abilities at their disposal, they're working through. And I mean, I got to use it again. They have the soul behind them so that you're fighting them. I know that's not the best comparison. It's not the best answer. Or anything.
Oh, so we need to bring back Alliance player. I'm like, heck yeah, I killed that Alliance player. And then I wish I had the cool flag that I could put on their body that gives them a big thumbs down.
Yeah, there you
go. So to make the fights better, we have to combine the champions fight from Trial of the Champion.
No, I'm not saying that a PvP Braun fight Jam, is what we
Godfather
need.
Godfather of Souls from Soul Furnace. And we'll have like a PvP fight with Soul as a raid boss. That's what you're saying?
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. Exactly.
No, I get what you're saying, DG, with like, I want to be there for the people. Yeah, me too. I think everybody does.
Mm-hmm.
But, and I think there's a couple things that we've tried to point out, which is, I think normal mode is a little too highly tuned.
Yes.
If it was a little more flex mode, it would give you exactly what you wanted. But I don't think that makes the fights better. Like, I might have a better time raiding, but it doesn't make the fights itself better. So talking from the perspective of I want the fights to be better, that's where I'm talking about the, like, am I fighting mechanics or am I fighting the boss? Yeah, it doesn't matter as much if I'm having fun. I don't care as much. That's why I've been able to get through some raids that haven't been the best raids in the world, is I've had cool people to talk to while I'm doing it. Mm-hmm. But now that we're down to, okay, let's assume that we're all there and we're having a good time, are these fights interesting? I think it felt cooler when I felt like I'm fighting this boss. And yeah, there are mechanics associated with it, but it's because that's what I was doing with the boss. Like, you know, like Ben was saying, like, this boss shoots lasers at me. I'm not thinking of it in the perspective of I need to line up and do this thing. I mean, sure, we talked about it and all of that, but he's shooting lasers at us and his hand exploded into little rubbles and all of that. Like, I felt like I was fighting that guy as opposed to, like, I'm doing a dance to avoid his moves.
So that goes back to my other point with the, you know, the voice acting adding character to the, you know, maybe it doesn't have to all be funny, but they have to have character to them. Something you can identify and connect with. When they're all just big dudes who kind of roar at you, there's no connection there. The character on which the mechanics hang is so thin and just a mindless monster that you can't see the character for the character, you just see the mechanics.
Yeah.
So maybe they need to inflate the characters more. And they don't have to be, you know, they don't have to have appeared in two zones while leveling and a quest line at max level over here and then a series of daily quests for you to have that character in them. You can just have a few. The best characters I've seen in Warlords of Draenor, the guys in Iron Docks. That's what I do, Zogosh. I think good. Zogosh and his captain. Those two guys are the best guys in all of Warlords of Draenor to me. Because running that dungeon, you hear their commentary the whole time you're fighting. And Zogosh is just panicking and freaking out. And the captain is just making the backhanded comments left and right. I love that dungeon for that reason alone. I will run that dungeon any day.
Backhand and compliments.
The fights in there are eh, but I will run that every day because just those guys are fun to hear. Fun to hear them talking and it's like, the saber, we haven't fed him since we found it. Put a muzzle on it, so gosh. Oh, good idea, sir. I didn't mean the cat.
Yeah, backhanded compliments. That's like hanging out with John.
Thanks.
And I have fun raiding with him.
Are you calling John the captain now?
No, I completely agree. And the problem is that I think a lot of the stuff that Blizzard has done as far as bosses that are interesting and bosses that are fun, it comes very organically. I mean, I don't know if they knew that they were going to create a meme when they had Thorim say, I remember you from the mountains. Like, I don't know if they ever thought, well, somebody's one day going to put this to music. Won't that be great? Like, I don't think people thought XT was going to be the funniest thing in the world at the time. Like, even though he's this Majin Buu sounding annoying creature, like, you don't know what's going to catch on. Sometimes I feel like it's forced. Hans and Franz feels like a real...
In retrospect, Hans and Franz feels very forced in a raid where there's no real standouts. Even the train guy feels like he should have been that jokey voice, but he just didn't have enough character to him. You know, he's concerned about the trains. Whoop-de-doo. He's a prolonged trash fight.
Yeah. So it's always interesting to see what takes off, but I do think you're right. I do think there are too many fights that are just people growling at one another and not enough character being added to them. So I'm with you on that as well.
Yeah. Have someone make fun, you know, bring back the Four Horsemen style. Have someone sit there and taunt us for a boss fight in trash. You know, then when we actually get to them, then it'll feel like something. You know, you've been bugging us for, you know, the whole last week's progression night when we were downing the last boss. And you sit there and mock us. You know, Nefarian in Black, in Blackwing, whatever, the second Blackwing one.
Descent.
Yeah, Blackwing Descent. Yeah, him sitting there taunting you. And if you're not that heroic, no, he just sits there and taunts you. He sits there and powers up the other bosses and... You know, then when you finally beat all of them on Heroic, he goes, wow, you certainly did a great job. Bravo. Here, have a title. Slayer of stupid, incompetent, and pointless minions. You know, best title in the game. Nefarian has character. I would love to see him come back again. Kalthus has character. I would love to see him come back again. At this point, I don't care if he's just a skeleton.
Like a robot that has a head on it. Or a body with a robot head is pretty much what their
cyborg
options
skeleton.
Are for Kael'thas at this point.
Yeah.
I say take
a page out of Diablo's book. I mean, one of my favorite moments in the Diablo expansion is there is a point where you are you're making your way to go fight the final boss you're working with. I'm terrible with the angel names, but the big angel guy. I can't think of his name right now. But he's a badass. He wants nothing to do with you. He hates you, but he's going to help you anyway. And as you're running, all of a sudden you get surrounded by bad guys and you start fighting him and all of that. And he just comes flying out of nowhere, hits the ground, and wipes out all of them in a single blow and says, I told you I don't like to wait. Yeah, it's Imperious. That's what
yep.
it was. So then you move forward a little bit more. Same thing happens. You get surrounded by all these minions, and he hits, and he's just like, hurry up, mortal, and then keeps going again. Like, how funny would it be to have a place like Siege of Orgrimmar that's so full of trash, you're making your way down the hallway, you've got the boss taunting you like, come, I dare you, you can't stop me, and all of a sudden you're fighting this trash, and he kills his own trash leading up to him, and like... Hurry! Like, I said, come on! I like that scenario mostly because it involves me not having to fight trash.
Yeah, I figured.
That would be a great point of character. It's like, no, I will finish you myself! Come! And he just slays like the last three guys and jumps backwards into his arena pit or whatever he's got waiting for you.
Yeah, but if he's down in the arena pit, let's just throw stuff at him.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll stay out. It's like, oh, you've outsmarted me this day. Blah.
Except not, and he hits a button, and you all get tossed into the arena by like spring-loaded platforms.
Oh, well, see that there goes that fun factor. You just lost it.
But still, it'd be fun. All of a sudden, everyone just gets tossed in, lands down. He starts laughing at you, but he doesn't activate immediately. You know, he waits for you to get up and fight because he's honorable.
See, these are things where it's like, if you could legitimately play on conventions, like if you could make a fight that seemingly had a way to cheese it, but then the boss called you on it and punished you somehow for doing it, like that's the kind of crap that would be hilarious and add a ton of character to a boss. Mm-hmm. You know, like if there was a boss where it was like, hey, we can hit him from up here and he's not aggroing on us, we could all stand outside this arena and shoot down at him. Let's do that. That sounds like a good idea. And say you maybe get him down 10% of his health, and then he just says something like, enough of this foolishness, get in here, and activate something. Everybody gets pulled in, and he does a whirlwind and drops everybody to 50% health, and then the fight starts. People would remember that boss for forever.
or maybe he doesn't damage you, but he gets you all yanked in, and he has a little, and he summons an additional minion that comes out and heals him throughout the fight that you can't kill. It, like, it doesn't heal him for much, but it's slowly healing him over time. And that's your achievement version for the fight. You have to beat him with that minion up.
Like, that's the kind of stuff that I think is cool. That's the kind of stuff I would like to see. And you're right. That's the kind of stuff that adds character to a boss, is when stuff like that happens.
So like,
that's the most memorable thing I've heard from 6.1. The whole, if you're doing the Legendary Quest trade and you activate Anivia's Feather to get past the one part, Khadgar yanks you back down and goes, this is a stealth mission. Are you nuts just flying in there? They understood that there's a mechanic in the game that allows you to fly from point A to point B. You're supposed to sneak there with Garona and have her take out patrols. But if you try to fly there with a thing that allows you to fly, Khadgar yanks you down and tells you that you're crazy and tells you to do it the right way. They know how to do it. Why don't they more?
I think that's fun. And I think that's the kind of thing that they should even get out of like a beta test. Like if they see their beta testers are taking advantage of something or doing something, I think Blizzard turning those expectations on their head would be hilarious. Like I love that sort of stuff.
So more creative stuff, character development, and less just throwing mechanics at us would probably make us happier in the next tier.
Also, normal should be actually a good deal easier.
Yeah.
Yeah, with you on that. Tune it a little bit lower for people jumping, especially since we're going up to another raid tier.
I'm sure there are people out there who are normal raiders that are like, well, we didn't have any problem with it. Well, just keep in mind, normal is supposed to be the everybody gets in and everybody gets to see it. Mm-hmm. So if you're scared about normal being made easier, then maybe you're actually a heroic raider. But for us, it seems like we were banging our head in the last tier, although it seems like it was a good deal easier. It seems like you guys are banging your head on this tier, and that doesn't fit with kind of what I would expect from a normal raid scenario.
Yeah, I mean, back when we were in Siege, we'd get to those bosses that we bang our heads against, but it wasn't like this. We were still able to persevere through it without, like, as much frustration. I think, like, Gary was the biggest frustration that we had, but, I mean, he's the end boss. That kind of makes sense.
Right.
We struggled with, what was it, the third boss for a while, but I also feel like it was easier to out-gear that place than it has been.
It's not
so
personal
far.
Responsibility with mechanics.
Yeah.
So. Well...
You know, and Blizzard also proves time and again that it nostalgia cannot carry anything. And that'd be my one thing I'm going to worry about for Hellfire Citadel going forward. Because nostalgia isn't carrying us through, you know, Blackrock Foundry on the Gruul and some of the other throwbacks. It didn't carry us through the Molten Core looking for raid at all. Mm-hmm. That just became tedious instantly. Nostalgia does not carry things alone. It can add flavor, but you can't survive on cinnamon.
Well, yeah, cinnamon's horrible.
That sounds like a challenge.
Okay, John, yes, I challenge you to survive on nothing but cinnamon for the next week.
And listeners, that is not a challenge for you. We do not condone living only on cinnamon. Besides, tigers hate cinnamon.
You must at least also eat potatoes and butter, because potatoes and butter you can subsist on. It has all the ingredients needed for life.
Booyah. Well, okay. With that, I'm going to close up our roundtable that technically never started. But we're also going to be skipping news. We'll talk about some of that stuff later if it still matters next week. But we did get one of these.
Celebrity Murloc Theater.
John, what's a Celebrity Murloc Theater?
Ben, a Celebrity Murloc Theater is where you, the listeners, can go ahead and submit to us your own creation where you impersonate a Murloc or a Murloc celebrity. Basically, every week that we feature a Celebrity Murloc Theater, we're going to be giving money to Child's Play charities at the end of the year, and it's a good way to go ahead and support a charity and have a little bit of fun. There are three ways you can submit it to us. The first is to go ahead and send us an audio recording of yourself doing an impression of a Murloc, like Ben's going to do. The second is to go ahead and do an impression of a Murloc celebrity, like DG's about to do.
My gurgle.
Okay, let's keep it under a minute. That's another important part of the rule. And the third way is to go ahead and take audio from a movie or TV show and throw in a Murloc where you feel is appropriate, which is what our submission is this week.
Yep. And Haster, thank you very much for sending in to Celebrity Murloc Theater. And away we go. I said, away we go. All right. Hold on. Backup coming up in a second here.
Hold on. Let's all react. As if we're...
And away we go.
It is one thing to question the official story and another thing entirely to make wild accusations or insinuate that I'm a superhero.
I never said you were a superhero.
Didn't? Mm-mm. Well, good, because that would be outlandish and fantastic. I'm just not the hero type, clearly, with this laundry list of character defects, all the mistakes I made, largely public. Truth is, I am.
We're getting to a weird place with Celebrity Murloc Theater, Ben.
Yeah, we are.
We're getting to a weird place where I feel like people just want to play monologues and have the monologue end with the sound of a Murloc. I'm not entirely sure how I feel about it, but it's where we chose this, Ben.
Yeah, we did. It's fine. I'm happy with it. It was funny. It made me laugh.
My co-host, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
So thank you, Haster. That's another week in the bank.
Woohoo! Also, one last thing. We did get a little listener feedback today.
We sure did.
Specifically to you, John.
Yes, this was addressed specifically to me. It was not addressed to the show. Let's just get right into it. Linux Gamer tweets at @John_Jagger. I lost all my respect to the podcast. WoW sucks, and I'm never coming back.
That's it.
I would love to have a follow-up dialogue, but he also proceeded to block me right after.
That I didn't know so, that.
Yeah. So.
What did you do?
It raises a lot of questions. So, I'm not entirely sure what it means. Let's break this down for a moment, okay? He's lost all respect to the podcast.
I'm assuming it's our show.
It could be.
Or maybe he was saving characters and meant the podcast community.
I also think he means for the podcast.
Okay.
Is he what? I mean, we weren't getting paid in respect at any time.
No.
I don't respect this show.
Heck, Alora for real said in the chat room, I lost all respect a long time ago. I mean, everybody has.
Yeah.
Lowest common denominator of humor.
Check your respect at the door before you come in.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. So he no longer respects the show. WoW sucks and I'm never coming back. This is where he kind of confuses me to some degree, because are we the reason WoW sucks, Ben?
I think so.
You know what I think, happened here? I think something you said on a past show hit a nerve with him, and he went on like a quiet, contemplative walk around the city with like, you know, slow music playing in his headphones, and he just thought about what you said and went, my God, they're right. That's why WoW is so bad.
But he never heard about
it. And you made him realize he's been playing World of Warcraft for maybe 10 years now. And he's hated it all along. And you brought him to the realization of why he hated it so much with your words.
Then he should thank me. I'm saving his 15 bucks a month.
And so he lost all respect for the podcast. Because you're still playing the game that he realized he's hated for 10 years.
Mad respect to the podcast because you taught me that WoW sucks and I'm never coming back.
But here's the thing. We don't say that WoW sucks. We try to get...
He tweeted me.
Yeah, true. Okay. I love WoW.
He didn't even block the show. I'm the only one who got blocked.
Why?
Also, he only blocked my new account, so I could totally tweet him from my old one if I wanted to, but I don't want it. I'm having much more fun speculating what he meant than actually trying to contact him and find out what it means. But, all right, well, you know, I'm sorry we broke WoW. We'll try and make WoW better, I guess. That's anybody
what
we've
else. We've always tried to make it better.
Yeah, I guess.
Oh. The reason he really lost all respect for the podcast was he was one of the multi-boxers. He had 3 million accounts, John. You single-handedly caused the user crash.
Yeah, that's
single-handedly.
It.
You got the one guy that was so deep into this to realize he hated the game.
So here's
the thing.
He had to
tweet you and let you know and then block you.
If you are still listening for me, like, you know, if you just ignore John... Right in. Let me know what's going on because I'm curious.
Oh my gosh, Ben, we need to, next April, we need to release three shows. A John Free version, a Ben Free version, and then the regular show. we should do a John Free version of the show just for this guy. Be like, look, I understand you lost respect for the podcast. You tweeted at John. It's clearly he's the problem. He's the problem for a lot of people. This isn't the first time he's been the sole focus of all the negative feedback. We at Azeroth Roundtable hear you. We understand your concerns. We are now doing a John-free version of the podcast. And it'll just be you and the guest through the whole thing, but you'll still be reacting to me as if I was here. They just won't ever hear it.
5 minutes of silence. That's a really good point, John.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of silence because I talk a lot.
Yeah. So what we're going to do at that point, we'll do this. We will.
We'll come up with something.
Yeah. I already know how to record it.
Don't worry, Linux Gamer. We'll get you back.
Yeah. So
we'll come up with a good way to get rid of me and you'll be back in because we'll do anything to get just one person back.
I got it. I figured it out. The reason that Linux Gamer lost all respect for the podcast is because they bought one of our shirts, but it didn't start a conversation because they didn't leave their house.
I bet. You know, we did have some speculation that this was ad-related, Ben.
Yeah, that is true.
So here's what I'm proposing, Ben.
Okay.
We're going to do a professional t-shirt advertisement. Are you ready?
Yes.
Hello, Ben.
Why, hello, John.
Did you know that if you enjoy our show and would like to find some way to support our show, there's a very easy way?
What is it?
You can go to a website called slashloot.com. Under the podcast section, you can select Azeroth Roundtable. There you'll be able to purchase the Azeroth Roundtable t-shirt. It's a shirt that contains our original logo, which has our Murloc with the mic on it. Mm-hmm. And we do receive a small percentage of the profits for these shirts, which help fund this podcast.
Oh, we do. That's helpful.
If you already have a shirt, don't want shirts, we do have alternative ways that you can obtain support our show and obtain goods for it. You can go to geekasylum.etsy.com, which is where you can find the official Azeroth Roundtable keychain and Azeroth Roundtable necklace.
Mm-hmm.
These also show support for the show and continue to keep us on the air, giving you high-quality advertisements such as this.
John, did you know that at geekasylum.etsy.com, there might not be a picture right now, but there are actually two different versions of the pendant slash keychain that you can get?
I did not. This is exciting news, Ben. Why don't you tell everybody what the new version of the pendant is?
Well, we have our classic logo, which everybody knows and loves, which you can get on that shirt from slashloot.com. But we also have a newer version on the pendant that has the Murloc with a mic from our overlay. If you go to youtube.com/AzerothRT?
Yes. Okay, I was pointing at the Murloc.
Yeah. You can actually get that on a keychain or necklace. It's
the
Murloc
fantastic.
With
the
mic. It is.
It's just a cool way for you to support our show and get some loot out of it. We believe that you should get something for supporting our show. So there you go.
All right. Hope that was professional enough.
I felt professional. I sat upright.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying so hard just not to shout in, "Wait, there's more!" Something during it. Just like, you guys are being too serious. Need to interrupt. Must not interrupt because important.
Well, you know what else is important? DG, how can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at DG Dragon. You can listen to my show at thegroupquest.com. We record every Saturday live at twitch.tv/group_quest. And that's Saturday afternoon at 4:30 Central Time, so 5:30 Eastern, 2:30 Pacific. My co-hosts are Haster and Golvin. Haster is the one who submitted this week's Celebrity Murloc Theater, and Golvin does a show called Monkcraft Podcast. So there's all that. You can find more stuff from me pretty much anywhere you find the name DG, D-E-G-E-I, or DG Dragon.
Perfect. John, how about you?
Well, if you want a fun person to air your strangely worded grievances to and then block, you can do that on my Twitter account. It's at John_Jagger. It's your number one stop for griping at me specifically in regards to the show. So do that today. You can also find me on YouTube. You can find Ben there too, but mm-hmm. I run it. And that's youtube.com/AzerothRT. You can see the overlay we talked about. And every Saturday, you can find me on the NVIDIA stream on Twitch along with Scott Johnson. That's at twitch.tv/NVIDIA from 3 to 6 Pacific Standard Time.
Yep. If you're looking for me, you can find me on Twitter. I am at LTheMage. I also do a show called Battle Pets, a show called Geektopia. That's about it for now. As for this show, you can always follow us on Twitter. We are at AzerothRT. If you have any questions, comments, you want to tell us what you think Linux Gamer meant, you can go ahead and email those to AzerothRoundtable@gmail.com. And anytime you want to listen to us, guess what? There are ways. Find us on Stitcher, TuneIn, iTunes, and also AzerothRoundtable.com. All of our episodes, all the time. As for our intro, it does contain music from Volatile Reaction by Kevin MacLeod. You can find more of his music at incompetech.com.
Now, quick, Ben. Allura for real says she's going to quit WoW because we did a serious ad. So how about this? Hey, Ben!
Hey, John!
Oh my gosh, you know what's better than being naked?
Buying shit!
Yeah, buy shit from AzerothRoundtable.com, but you can't.
Well, you can, because there's links on there.
Oh, hot dang, I'm going to go there buy a shirt today.
Woohoo! Yeah!
Ben, what's your favorite part about monster trucks?
The engine.
Because the engine makes it purr nice and purdy.
Yeah, perfect.
Ben killed me with that. I had no response. I had a whole list of replies I thought he might say. Didn't expect the one I got, so...
Oh, I forgot to mention, we are coming up on episode 200 of Groupquest, and we have a contest, so if you go listen to the recent episodes, there's stuff for giving away, including Blizzard money and time card. Should have mentioned that.
That's okay, I'm still recording, so it'll be on the podcast!
Yay!
The engine!
And now we stopped recording.
The engine.
Oh, man. So we've got an extra special treat tonight.
Yes.
Ooh.
An extra, extra special treat.
It's special.
So special.
Sexy.
Extra special.
Extra special.
Nipple covers? What? Oh, my.
Nipple covers. Oh, man. Our next t-shirt, Ben, should have fake nipple rings on it.
I actually thought you just put
more
Murlocs
go here and arrows pointing.
Two Murlocs, one over each nipple.
Like hanging from them.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, that's not going to happen.
I want to do a Heroes of the Storm shirt for Asmodan, and it says nipple rings on the shirt.
Just
and
quote
on the back it says hashtag Team Asmodan.
No. You need to have the two nipple rings and then, like, in metal chain links between them, it says, get dunked.
Now have the quote from basketball. You think you're excited? Feel these nipples.
Kotaku wrote a whole article about Asmodan's
I saw
nipple
that,
rings.
And I was sad.
I felt super vindicated by it.
Oh, yes.
Like, all right.
Your bikini stitches.
Finally justified. Finally. Justified.
I need.
Oh god! I just had the mental image of Asmodan taking bikini stitches on a date.
He's the Lord of Sin.
Yeah.
Oh, I can just picture that now.
Stitches, are you hungry?
Asmodan talks a lot like Stitches.
I know. I don't know how
Stitches
he talks.
Stitches always hungry.
Stitches talks a lot like a weird Smeagol. Like a Smeagol that got kicked in the throat.
Column.
Yeah, that's where the coughing comes from.
Filthy hobbitses, I'll show you the way.
Stupid hobbitses.
Hi, everybody, I'm Smeagol.
No, stupid Joe. I'm Smeagol.
I'm smoking Smeagol.
It's a new action figure you can get.
I'm going to light up a whole pack in the fires of Mount Doom.
Well, yeah, at the end he was a smoking Smeagol. Spoilers.
It's well past spoiler territory for that.
That's why I said spoilers after the fact.
Except now I'm just picturing him sitting at the ledge of the volcano just smoking.
Like his rock in the first movie, he's just laying there on the edge, dipping the cigarette down to the lava to light it.
Oh, geez. Sam and Frodo are just reclining on their backs, looking up at the sky. He's just, like, smoking. Sam's just like, I don't trust you, Mr. Smeagol. He's just like, fuck you.
It says, what do you think the stars is ours?
They're fireflies, Mr. Colum. Fireflies, I get caught up in that big blue thing.
Why did Lord of the Rings become Lion King?
Because Gollum is Simba.
Because Gollum's smoking, that's why.
And somehow Frodo is... I don't know why. It just is.
I can't support this cross-pollination of properties.
All right.
I didn't mention the B-movie.
Feels gross.
Seinfeld has nothing to do with this.
Oh.
The less people mention the B-movie, probably the better.
I forgot it existed. Why did you do that to me?
You know what was the weirdest part about the B movie was how way into fucking bees Jerry Seinfeld got.
Yeah.
Actually, like, I'd say the weirdest thing about the B movie to me at this point is the fact that you actually saw it.
Yeah.
No, it was that Jerry Seinfeld out of nowhere, he just like would go on comedy shows and people are like, it's Jerry Seinfeld from Seinfeld. And he's like, I want to talk about bees. And like that, like he's just would talk about bees seriously.